It is hour number two of Shirts and Skins with Chad and Trey. At 1:45, where are we at in society? Cancel culture goes meta with the Office TV show. At 1:30, we look back at the college football weekend, including Clemson having some serious issues. Georgia does not look like they have their offensive situation figured out, and more from around the country. And in mere minutes, it is our weekly chat with the great Joe Cook of Inside Texas and On 3. I'm Trey Elling. Sitting across from me is Chad Hastings.
Yeah, hour number two. If you'd have told me that that game would – look, I love defense. I'm all about good defense. But if you tell me there are no offensive touchdowns in the Clemson-Georgia game in 2021, I'd have said you're crazy. Like, there's no way anyone would have bet that, Trey. There's no way anybody would think that could be possible. A pick six is the only touchdown created in that ballgame.
The Clemson quarterback's going to have to play better if I'm ever going to even make an effort to figure out his last name. Because,
that's
look,
fair.
I understand the line in front of him was not blocking well. He was locking onto receivers in a major way, too, though, and that led to the pick six.
The other thing you brought up that's critical, and I'll throw this stat before we get to Joe Cook, but you mentioned Travis Etienne on Friday and how important you thought he was for them to lose. I was with you because I'm such an Etienne guy. I loved his development at Clemson. Did you see the rushing yard number for Clemson?
I did not.
Two. Not 32. Not 42. Two.
Like 2 yards per carry?
No, 2 yards total for
wow.
The game.
Oh, boy.
For Clemson. And if I'm – I don't have the thing pulled up, but I believe this is right. No one other than DJ – and you got to have all the, you know, the sack yardage and everything factored in. Nobody other than DJ Uiagalelei carried the ball more than 4 times.
Oh, boy.
So they didn't even really give it a full shot because they realized they couldn't get anything done against that Georgia defense. Now, we probably find out, Trey, that Georgia defense is just badass.
Well, of course we knew that.
It's that. And some of the – they're so badass, they had to send guys to Florida State, and they looked pretty good last night after transferring.
Yeah.
But so they're really, really good. But now, man, that ACC is a wild story where North Carolina looked like that after losing so much talent. Clemson's lost a lot of talent. I think the message...
Miami got Brock back down to earth.
Now, Miami, yeah, right. No, we don't need to mention them as any kind of factor. But what we do know is that discussion of, you know, that idea of locking Clemson into a playoff spot, I think we can make that fluid right now.
Look, their schedule sucks the rest of the way, so they do still have a fairly easy route to win out, even if they have some serious flaws that will ultimately trip them up against other good competition. But I think this game needs to be kept in mind. Regardless of whatever Clemson does the rest of the way, if we're talking about 5 or 6 teams who have a legitimate argument to make it into the college football playoff, one of them being Clemson, and they look pretty good the rest of the way, but you still have to think about what happened game 1 versus Georgia. That needs to count at the end of the year.
It will be fun to see how they react. Dabo's a hell of a coach, and they do have a lot of talent there, so we'll see how they rebound. They don't play North Carolina. They don't play Notre Dame. NC State is a game to maybe pay attention to on their schedule. So we'll definitely talk some more college football around the country, but let's focus in on the Longhorns here. The Vaqueros Cafe and Cantina Hotline brings us our normal Monday visit with Joe Cook of Inside Texas. Inside Texas and the new relationship with On3.com gets you even more as you get your Longhorns covered. He's at JosephCook89 on Twitter as well. Joe, how are you?
Doing great, guys. Thanks again for having me on. Happy Labor Day.
Yes, happy Labor Day to you. Obviously, labor, we focus on the labor part with all this football going on. I heard you ask a question at the press conference. We'll get to that. But let's go back to the game on Saturday. Coach Sarkisian certainly off to a good start with a 20-point victory. Give us your overall thoughts on it, and then we'll dig in.
I think that you can look at all three phases of the game. You can look at special teams. You can look at offense. You can look at defense, and then you can go position by position, quarterback, running back, you know, all over the field, and still be able to identify places that the team definitely needs to improve on. But all that came with a 3-possession 20-point win. I think that's what's the most encouraging part, is that all this happened with the backdrop of a 20-point win against a ranked team. And I think that going – now that came against, or that comes ahead of going on the road to a good but not great team, most likely, but in an extremely hostile environment. I think that it went about as well as Steve Sarkisian could have asked for, and now this week of practice is going to be shored up everything and get ready for a tough environment.
Joe, you've been on the Longhorn beat for a while now. Is this the most complete game that you've watched the Longhorns play against good competition? And if not, what was the last one that maybe tops this?
Ooh, that's a good question. I'm trying to think back on some of the various games I've seen.
The closest that I can come is that Georgia game in the Sugar Bowl, but I feel like they weren't as good offensively as they were defensively that day.
Right. Maybe even that Iowa State game that same season in 2018, that they won 24-10 and basically controlled 24-3. It's hard to think of anything that looked, you know, where competency and completeness was all over the field. I was talking to a couple friends of mine who made it into town. I mean, did y'all even notice Brendan Schooler or BJ Foster? And I don't say that as a bad thing. I think that's a good thing. Like, I didn't even notice Texas' two starting safeties, and I think that's indicative of good defensive line and linebacker play. I know that fans probably wanted to see a little bit more from, you know, havoc created by the defensive line, but they, for the most part, they did their job. I can't think of I still have some questions about this Louisiana team. I really want to see how they go throughout the rest of their schedule, but even coming into this game, you know, we knew that they were experienced at the very least, and they had some good players and spots, and we never saw that experience come to bear. We never saw anything that showed that, oh, this is how they've won all these games. Texas seemed to really just control it. So, Nate, I'm that Georgia game maybe, that Iowa State game maybe, but yeah, it's hard to think over the past, what, this is year six for me, I believe, or season six. It's hard to think over the past three head coaches and countless coordinators and in season openers if I saw a, you know, just a good all-around effort like that.
I'm with you on the safety position. As a matter of fact, the best play made by a safety all night was when BJ Foster snuffed out that onside kick attempt and made a really athletic play to cover it before Louisiana had a chance to do so. I think that does speak to the job being done by the defensive linemen and the linebackers. As a matter of fact, even though both linebackers, starting linebackers that is, end up with more than 10 tackles apiece, I think that not really recognizing any one guy as standing out amongst the others is a hallmark of the Kwiatkowski defense. And I think that shows that every single one of those guys was doing their job, that you weren't having to ask too much of the safeties and the cornerbacks weren't having to come up with too many big plays or pass breakups because that defensive line was doing their job, keeping the quarterback in their pocket, and the linebackers were doing a great job of cleaning up the mess, especially with the run game.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'm just trying to think. What, you didn't really notice Luke Brockermeyer or DeMarvin Overshown having to chase plays down or having to recover as a result of mistakes, whether those mistakes were made in front of them or by them themselves. It was a lot of them just making plays in general, and I think it speaks to what you were talking about, that everything looked pretty darn competent all over the field, and those two reap the benefits of it, definitely. We'll see if they're able to continue to reap those benefits going forward because, like I mentioned, I think you do want to see more havoc and disruption caused by your D-line. You want to see more of those plays like the ones that Ovi Ogofu and Jet Bush and even Ray Thornton started to make late in the game. That's something you want to see over the course of the game and the early portions of it, and not just right when it's time to put the game away.
Talking with Joe Cook, InsideTexasOn3.com. Joe, coming out of it, not a lot of serious injury discussion today with Sark, but just to get it out there, you know, there was the Angelou situation, Deshaun Jameson, maybe just got the wind knocked out of him or whatever it was, but he was back in the game a little bit after that. And then Bijan Robinson once again showed us that he doesn't appear to have human ligaments and tendons on a particular play, but he was able to pop up like he seems to do, like he certainly did that day in Lubbock. Any concern for you on any injuries that you guys are hearing at Inside Texas?
Nothing with Bijan, nothing with Deshaun. I think you heard Steve Sarkisian gave basically a non-update regarding a couple different players. We were not sure if Jared Wiley was going to be able to get into the game. He obviously fought through whatever was afflicting him throughout the course of last week, but obviously he did not receive a whole lot of snaps. Cade Brewer and Gunnar Helm were there to take his spot. So that's somebody we're watching to see if his upper body can make it and recover a little bit for this upcoming game. And then also Junior Ongulau, we all saw him hobble off, and I think a lot of other offensive linemen around the country would have had to get crutches or get helped off. Junior Ongulau is not like a lot of different offensive linemen. That's one of the toughest guys on the team, and you know, for him to be hobbling like that, that's definitely something to notice. So we'll see. Hopefully, we'll get some more information on that on Inside Texas over the course of the week, and hopefully all those guys are ending up a little bit more healthy as Saturday approaches.
Joe, there's obviously a lot of good stuff that can be, put out in this game. Let me just give you kind of three guys to talk about at once. The combination that we saw of Hudson Card at quarterback, of Jordan Whittington doing what he did, especially on third downs, and just that usage for Bijan Robinson had to be so great for Texas fans to see. You don't just cover this team. You're a fan as well. Just talk about the usage of those three guys, because it felt effortless to me as I watched the game. By the end of it, you know, Sark had definitely shown off all three guys.
Yeah, definitely with Bijan, we all knew he was going to get handed the ball a lot. And he was handed the ball a lot over the course of this game. I really liked what I saw from him in the pass game. I think we saw that two-way go route where he just turned a guy around and got up the field and helped Texas get in position to score, I believe. Hudson Card, he looked like a talented freshman quarterback. There's obviously going to be some things for him to work on, but, you know, protected the football, made plays with his legs when he needed to, made plays with his arms, didn't seem to really try to force anything too much. I thought he played a really smart game and showed off why so many people believe in the talent that his arm has. And then Jordan Whittington, Texas brought him out in the post-game interview room, and as he was leaving, I had seen him play at Cuero High School plenty of times over the past, I think, 4 or 5 years or so, and I told him, like, look, I haven't seen you do things like that since you were wearing green. And it was great for him to make it through. You know, we've seen him struggle to get through game one of a season over these past 2 years, and to see him not only succeed, to see him put a guy just on the turf, just with a move so nasty that it may have inflicted a little bit of damage on his health. That's the type of Jordan Whittington that, you know, received that 5-star athlete ranking and had so much hype every single year. And for him to finally do that and not just show that he's just an athlete, but that he has got a lot of good polish on him as a skilled receiver, that was really exciting. I think that guy is going to be Texas' number one wide receiver this year, and looking forward to see what he can do going forward.
Joe, is Jordan Whittington the most important player on this roster right now? I know there's an argument to be made about Bijan Robinson since he is this team's Heisman hopeful, but considering what is behind Whittington at the wide receiver position, is he the most important guy for the success of this football team going forward?
No, because I'm still going to stick with Bijan on that front, because if you don't have that running threat, doesn't matter who's at receiver, it's not going to work for them. But I do think that he's definitely the most important person in that passing game. He's probably the receiver that Texas can rely on most to get open and also just know where to be. Even Steve Sarkisian talked today about he's a guy who knows pretty much all the different wide receiver roles for this team. He's someone who, you know, his athletic talent is matched by the way he dedicates himself to the game and understands where to be. So I'll still go Bijan as far as to the success of the whole offense, but I'm with you in how important he is, and I think that the passing game definitely hinges on his ability to be on the field.
What does the offensive line need to be better at in Fayetteville this weekend?
Oh boy, a lot of different places. It's going to be interesting to see how they decide to shake things up. Once Junior Ongulau left the game, I think y'all saw Hayden Connor come in and play at that guard spot. Curious to see if that's the that five that's the five that they go with, whether it remains Christian Jones, Denzel Okafor, Jake Majors, Hayden Connor, and Derek Kerstetter. I think with the way this team is going to emphasize outside running, there's going to be a, why don't you just line it up and run it down their throat instead of just, you know, running it outside. They kind of run it outside because that's their strength. They're not as great right now at just running it straight up the middle. I think we saw that, or inside. I think we saw that play out a little bit. A lot of the guys look good on the move, and I think that's why you see the outside running game work. But they definitely need to, I think, just shore up their ability in one-on-one situations. There were some times, especially on the interior, where some guys got pushed back. And that was where Louisiana had some skill on their defense, was in the defensive interior. But this is a group that definitely needs to start winning their one-on-one battles, because there's going to be more guys like that, like Taylen Humphrey, on Arkansas than there was this past week on Louisiana.
Joe, last one from me. Let's talk about the depth at running back. Keelan Robinson ends up with 8 carries. I'm seeing 10 total touches for Roshan. 8 carries, those 2 pass catches were pretty darn good on an average as well. So what'd you think of those 2 guys finding their place after Bijan?
I think they did about as well as they needed to. I don't think it was anything super spectacular outside of Rashawn Johnson's hurdle, but I don't think they need super spectacular from those guys. They need just reliable players who can do good things on occasion, but reliable guys who don't create just a massive drop-off when Bijan Robinson comes off the field. At the same time, they're part of Bijan Robinson's success. I'm sure you saw them run a bunch of 2-back sets throughout the course of the game. And those guys are going to have to help out in the blocking. And Bijan's going to have to help them out, too, from time to time, just to mix things up. So I think they did exactly what they needed to do. They just need to be able to play at a level to where whenever Bijan comes off the field and gets his rest, that they're able to provide a level of play that isn't too far off and still puts pressure on the defense. And we know Rashawn Johnson can do that. We saw a run from Keelan Robinson that seemed to indicate that he can do that. And I'd like to see a little bit more of him going forward just to know what we can get from number 7. But they just have to make sure that there's not a dearth of talent at the position whenever Bijan's not on the field. And all signs indicate that's what they're going to be able to do.
Yeah, things certainly clicked for him on Saturday. 38-18, Texas 1-0 and getting ready for Arkansas. Check out Inside Texas on 3.com as we get ready for the game. At Joseph Cook 89 on Twitter is where you'll find him. We talk to Joe every Monday about this time. Joe, we appreciate it, man. Enjoy your Labor Day, and we'll talk to you next week.
Absolutely, guys. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Joe.
Joe Cook, just like us, working on a Labor Day. We hope you are not doing that. We hope you are slamming burgers and dogs and maybe steaks and beer and all that good stuff on a Labor Day, or just chilling out with us and enjoying your 1-0 record if you're a Longhorn fan. And maybe if that's not your team and your team ended up 1-0 after the first big weekend of college football, you're enjoying that as well. Up next, Cowboy fans hope they're going 1-0, but it's a little tougher now because their best offensive linemen can't play. We will tell you why, plus some of the other big stories around college football, including Georgia beating Clemson in a defensive rock fight that nobody expected. That's coming up on the Horn.
Shirts and Skins.
There's no competitors, time to say goodbye to the sun. It takes a better turn. Wake up, it's not your typical rehash. Something unpredictable, do you really know that? I will remember this one. I'm just on your momentum. Rock out and break up your own suppression. Like to see you having fun in the setting sun.
Trey's going 311 today. It's episode 311 of our show, so we figure good Labor Day vibe, little 311, nothing wrong with that. Have a burger, have a dog, have a beer, have something heavier, and then listen to some 311. That's a good idea. Trey, what's this one called?
Sunset in July.
There you go. Definitely no sun setting on the way the Longhorn season started. It was all sun because it started at 3:30 and it didn't go away. Hopefully all of you got through the game okay. As we're down on Bevo Boulevard getting Longhorn game day rolling, a dude literally passed out right on the side of our stage.
Ooh.
Felt so bad for him. EMS was right there. Thanks to the EMS for doing such a great job. They had three people over there very quickly. But I am told he was just sitting there, Trey. I don't even know if he was trying to recover, if he was what kind of drink he had on him or whatever. He just like slowly kind of hunched over and then he was flat on the ground. So thankfully didn't hit his head and they were able to take care of him. And thanks to all the medical folks because they had stations around this all around the stadium. And hopefully if people were feeling something like that, they were able to get help. But it was so hot on Saturday.
It was brutally hot on Saturday. I actually played some ball in the morning, and by our last game, which was just before noon, we were all ready to quit mid-game. It was that hot, and it just stayed that hot all the way through halftime for most people sitting in the stands. Fortunately, on the west side where we caught a break at about the end of the first quarter. We hit the shade, and
it was glorious.
Yep. All of a sudden, every 2-mile-an-hour gust of wind that you felt just was orgasmic. And for everybody else in the stadium, those of you on the east side especially, I feel for you. Mm. And just the amount of sacrifice that it requires for you to stay in the stands to watch that game. As a matter of fact, a lot of people on the east side hit eject at halftime, did not come back. I don't fault them at all for that.
No, I agree. And certainly the team gave them something good to look at. 38-18 was the final. We've been breaking that down throughout the day. We got a text in 337-3776, of course, is your Specs text line. A lot of love coming in for the teams and the coaches. Jeff Banks getting more love, saying, I really like how Coach Banks adjusted on punt returns. After the first called back touchdown, Luloff started angling kicks away from Jameson. We adjusted by putting two returners back to force them to kick to us. Small adjustment, but it shows that we're not going to just say, oh, shucks, guess we're not getting returns today. It's a good point. Coach Banks getting love for that. Coach Banks also getting love for telling his guys to watch out for that dribble onside kick. And if you watch B.J. Foster's eyes, and there was another player right there on the side. I can't remember exactly which guy it was. But two players specifically were looking out for that. B.J. Foster makes the great play there to cover it. And the details were covered, Trey. That's what it felt like more than anything else in this game. Adjustments, in-game adjustments. You could feel little things happening throughout the game. If something wasn't quite going the way Texas wanted it to go, it didn't feel like it just was left to its own devices. They fixed it.
Part of the reason why this game on Saturday felt so good for Texas fans is not only did you get a good effort on offense and defense, it felt like the coaching was better on our side than the other side, which is a pretty well-coached team, too. Billy Napier is a guy who has gotten it done with Louisiana for a few years now. He's rumored as a guy who could be in line for that next big-time program gig if an LSU or somebody like that wants to hire from the group of five ranks. And Texas had it buttoned up on all three facets of the game and then also coaching. Sarkisian talked about it in his press conference this morning. Things didn't go swimmingly for them on either side of the ball to start the game, but they made the adjustments, and by halftime, things were going better, and really it only got better from there. Now, I guess there is a bit of a nitpick, and Steve Sarkisian brought this up as well, not being able to finish Louisiana off when Texas had the ball on offense. You just need to pick up a couple first downs and the game is over. They could not do that, had to punt the ball back to Louisiana, who was driving at the end of the game, but even still, it was far-fetched that Louisiana was going to score right there, get two onsides, and eventually work their way back into the affair.
Yeah, no, there's the first thing he says today is that there's, you know, things to work on, but it's all fixable in his mind.
Absolutely.
I think that's sort of the overall feel of that game.
And considering just how bad things have looked with the two previous regimes, firing things up, Tom Herman versus Maryland, Charlie Strong game two versus UCLA, there are a lot worse places to be right now, and Longhorn fans understand that. This is a great way to get the season started, and the optimism is legit. This is not to say Texas is back, as much as I hate to utter those words, but I think that there is a realistic chance to see this Longhorn football team compete for a conference championship this year.
Yeah, and then the other thing we always forget, you always forget about coming into the year. Sometimes you can spend so much time bashing your head against your own team, you just forget about everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
Other teams have issues. Other teams have problems. Anybody notice that Iowa State beat Northern Iowa by 6?
Yeah.
Did anybody see that part? Because that happened. Now, it is also true, K-State beat Stanford. Bad.
Yeah.
K-State whipped Stanford 24-7.
I think says something about both programs.
It may. But it also might tell Texas they're going to need to pay attention to Kansas State even more than they might. Maybe we're going to have to. We'll get to all of that. But these kind of games, you got to beat what's in front of you, and they're going to play better offensive teams. What we knew about Louisiana came true. That quarterback cannot work the ball down the field, and you can combine that. Partially, Texas didn't let them. Partially, they're just, I don't think, know that they're that able to do it. But Texas did a great job of covering downfield, but the pressure was really good. The defensive front for the Longhorns, really, really impressive. When you pull up this box score here, to have 13 tackles from Overshown, 10 from Brockemeyer, and then the next guy is Ogofu. Really nice game for him. 7 total. He did have the sack, of course, coming from the edge on a third down play, I believe it was, when Ogofu got his sack.
That was a really nice play call there.
Big moment there. That's the other thing, just the little stuff, Trey, of I felt like communication was there for defense. I felt like blitzes made sense. I felt like they were aggressive when they needed to be, didn't seem afraid of stuff. And then you didn't have dumb silliness on offense. We didn't see just dumb silliness from offensive linemen. If you're going to get called for a hold every once in a while, that's football. But we didn't see a lot of those dumb false starts, offensive linemen not paying attention. I just felt like a lot of that was cleaned up.
There was only one play that I had an issue with on offense, and it was early in the game too. I think it may have been the first possession. It was like a 3rd and 6 or 7, and Hudson Card, you know, it's an obvious go route up the left sideline for Joshua Moore, who was well covered. I wasn't crazy about that play, but that was, again, early in the game. We didn't see anything else like that the rest of the way.
Yep, a lot to work on, obviously, and Hudson Card will continue to dial some stuff in. He showed off the arm a few times, but then, like you've talked about, there was some of that stuff on the longer routes that he's going to need to work on a little bit, put a little air under a ball, that kind of stuff. We'll continue to talk about Texas. Let us know what you think, 337-3776. Cowboys fire it up this week against Tampa Bay, and they'll do it without Zach Martin. He is out because he's on the COVID list. He is vaccinated but tested positive, and because of the protocols in place, he has to wait 5 days. So here's the weird irony, Trey. If they were playing on a Sunday, he could probably play. But because they, you know, I guess he tested positive, you know, sat over this weekend, he doesn't get that opportunity. So because if you're positive, or excuse me, if you're a vaccinated player, if you have a positive, you have to wait 5 days and then have back-to-back negative tests in a 24-hour period. That's what the protocol says. So this is probably a story, Trey, NFL fans are going to have to get used to, that this could happen to their team, this could happen to their guard, this could happen to their quarterback. Good news is Connor Williams comes off of that COVID list in time to play in the game, but I'd take that swap the other way if I could. Zach Martin being out is a big deal. McGovern at right guard, focus on that in this game, because the Bucs have some serious dogs coming up the middle.
They set the policy entirely too early in this whole process, Chad, considering how quickly things have changed over the last year and a half. I just don't agree with the idea that a vaccinated guy who tests positive for COVID, or an unvaccinated player for that matter, needs to sit out for X amount of time. Perhaps you give it a couple of days, then you start testing the guy, and if the person can test negative 2 or 3 straight days, we should be good for there. Maybe you say 2 days for vaccinated guys, 3 straight days for unvaccinated guys. The fact that we have vaccinated guys sitting out for 5 days and unvaccinated guys sitting out for 10 days, I don't think it follows what the science is currently telling us. Perhaps it's following what the science was telling us a year ago.
Right.
But a lot of that information is no longer the case.
That's the part of it that I really wish the NFL and these other leagues would focus in on. We haven't heard a whole lot of timetable discussions lately. They just, like, they set it out and they move on. But for the person right now, again, this is a vaccinated person who tests positive, and let's assume, I have not heard that he has any serious symptoms. Let's say he has little or no symptoms at that point.
If the person is asymptomatic, then I'm of the mindset that we shouldn't even be testing that guy, vaccinated or not.
But then here's the real question. If you're, I guess they're trying to ultimately protect unvaccinated guys on the team that they feel like might be exposed. So at this moment, what would be the danger of a vaccinated guy gets it? What is the chance that he spreads it to an unvaccinated player if he comes back in 2 days if he's got a negative test?
If you need to excessively test a guy, that's the perfect time to do so. You don't necessarily need to test the unvaccinated guys every day, because the likelihood that vaccinated or non is going to catch it and transmit it is very similar at this point, because the efficacy of the vaccinations wane, and also the way that the vaccinations work against Delta is greatly subdued. So I think if anything, you start to test the unvaccinated guys regularly if there is contact tracing, but you don't force them to sit out for 10 straight days at that point, or 7 days, or whatever the number is.
So Cowboys and Bucks, it's Connor McGovern at right guard for the Cowboys, and you got to cross your fingers that Lyle Collins is ready to go with those stingers he's been dealing with, that Connor Williams is good and back from the COVID list. They think he'll be good. And then Tyron Smith, of course, at left tackle. That's always a little bit of a coin flip in terms of his health. That is Thursday Night Football this week to crank everything up. College football, we've talked about not only the Texas game, but a very impressive win for Alabama. They're clearly the story of the country this weekend. But after that, it's probably Georgia. It was an ugly, weird game, but Georgia got the win, and now they've given themselves the opportunity to slip once, mm-hmm. where they didn't have that if they lose this game. Trey, now if you slip in the cocktail party, or maybe you slip at Auburn, those are kind of the two games that blink at me for Georgia. They don't play Bama in the regular season. They still have that opportunity to get to Atlanta and find their way to the playoff. But I'll admit, as I go rewatch that game this week, I'm going to be focused in on that Georgia offense, because Mr. Monken, Mr. Daniels, you're supposed to be better than that.
Mm-hmm.
I know Clemson's got players, but really? You don't produce a touchdown an entire football game?
That's not good.
That is not going to win this SEC, and it is not going to win this version of college football.
That could conceivably win the SEC 15 years ago. Not now, though.
Now, I'll tell you, I'll give them total credit. If they find a way to go to Atlanta and beat Alabama 10-3 to win that title, I will shut up, because I'll give you all credit for that if you figure out a way to do it, but I don't think you will.
I will strip naked and walk down the drag.
Exactly.
Next summer.
That is not happening. So a lot of stories out there. We talked about LSU's loss. North Carolina loses on Friday night. Mac Brown said overrated. Did you catch that?
Mac Brown called his own team overrated?
Yes. They asked him what happened. He said, well, we were overrated. That's what happened. Hal threw three picks in that ball game.
I saw Hal after the game saying that he had to be better for North Carolina, but they're missing a lot of skill guys from last year's team. I assumed that, coupled with Mac Brown teams knowing how to really crap the bed at the beginning of the season when too many expectations are heaped upon them, thought those two things were working against Mac going into that game. And Virginia Tech played a pretty solid game across the board, too.
Real quick before this break, how much of Notre Dame Florida State did you watch?
I watched bits and pieces, and then I watched the overtime.
Thoroughly entertaining ball game, but I don't know if either one of those teams is a threat at anything now, because it almost had that Texas Notre Dame feel from a few years ago, where it was an incredibly exciting game and all that, but then coming out of it, I just don't know. I'm not sure. Cone looked pretty good.
Cone set passing records for them last night, so Notre Dame fans have to feel at least a little bit better about the quarterback's position. The problem is, what's going on defensively for them? They gave up way too many big plays.
At 38-20, I just thought that thing was over.
I did too. I turned it off at that point.
For them to give that up, that's where it got away from them. Cone at times last night did not look like a Jag from Wisconsin. That was my concern for him coming in. He made some big boy deep accuracy throws for them. Mayer's a really good tight end, maybe the best in the country, and he's got some other weapons that are important, but I'm not quite sure. Getting in a dogfight, letting yourself have a dogfight with that Florida State team, I'm not sure what that means. I'm hoping it means Florida State's a little better, and then for the Notre Dame fan out there, maybe you are that kind of competitive. But I think in the case of like a Notre Dame and maybe even like an A&M, those teams are back into the top 10. Neither of them felt top 5-ish to me.
Mm.
They felt like they should be right where they are, maybe even down a little bit in a real, realm.
Here's the thing you have to keep in mind, though. It is just a game, and it's the first game of the season.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that they are playing in front of full stadiums once again, perhaps that factors into things. And it's why it's a good idea whether you were really good on Saturday or really bad on Saturday, you need to have a short memory, and you need to get ready for that next matchup. It's what Steve Sarkisian was preaching after the game on Saturday. He talked a little bit about that in the Monday presser today. You have to have a short memory in life, but especially in sports, because otherwise you are going to get too complacent from the successes that you have achieved up to this point, or you are going to remain too miserable with whatever failures existed versus learning those necessary lessons and move forward. It was nice that Texas had that complete performance in a victory over Louisiana. That was one freaking game, and it was the first game of the season. You cannot let that go to your heads. We've seen entirely too many Texas teams in football and in other sports, just a hint of success go to their heads in manners that we used to like to point to the Aggies and laugh about. That's happened a lot here in Austin over the last decade, but I think we have a guy in charge of the football program who's not going to let his guys get trapped in that manner anymore.
Obviously, a lot of Arkansas talk coming before the week is done. Today, we are recapping the win against Louisiana and getting you some thoughts from Coach Sarkisian's press conference. Remember, those pressers are going to be 11 o'clock moving forward each and every Monday, and we brought it to you earlier here on the Horn. It's on hornfm.com if you want to hear it in its entirety. Up next in Where We At in Society, Trey's going to tell you about cancel culture. Going after the office? Oh, come on. This is the Horn.
Shirts and Skins.
Chill. Right on my side as my ego becomes a funky child with some wood on my tongue. Be like in, take a breath, and my mouth gets loose. So while I scatter.
It is episode 311 of the show by Trey's Count. So he's going with 311 today. Nice chill out music to go with on a Labor Day. What do you got, Trey?
This is Down. That's the name of the song.
Hopefully you are getting a little downtime today. We are working. Somebody else texted. I'm also laboring on this Labor Day. It doesn't always feel like work for us because we get to talk a lot of football. And it is cranking up with the college side. We get NFL added this week. Cowboys Bucks on Thursday. And then, of course, the full weekend Red Zone Channel coming up this Sunday the 12th. Cannot wait for that. Thank you for all your texts. A lot of good stuff coming in on the Specs text line, 337-3776. A lot of people giving us their thoughts on the game itself, or maybe their thoughts on the stadium setup and kind of how they went through it, because it was an oppressively hot game. Somebody says, we were upper deck, east side, front row. Luckily in the south end, where we occasionally had a little bit of a breeze coming through, we lasted until halftime. Nobody's going to fault you for leaving that game early.
There were a lot of people on the east side who left at halftime. There is no problem with that. Oof. It was that hot that it was detrimental to people's health, as you guys saw firsthand on Bevo Boulevard right in front of you.
Somebody texted in, totally agree with the take on Sark, Trey. Like Saban, he knows how to view success like this with this week with a level head. Act like you have been there before. He does feel like that. I said to you last week, Trey, he feels appropriately boring to me. The press stuff, what he says, how he carries himself. And I think after the last guy you had at head coach, you need some of that. You need a business boring head coach. And say what we want about Saban, and we all know what Saban can do. Think about a guy even like Pete Carroll. Pete Carroll's a little bit of a wackadoo in some ways, but he's not a meathead. Saban's not a meathead, neither is he. Sark learned from them. Just feels like it's workmanlike.
Yeah, and even though it's a little bit boring, he also gives thoughtful answers, too. It doesn't feel like he's trying to BS you like the previous guy half the time he was talking to the media.
Yeah, and you know who else does that? Saban.
Yeah, that's true.
If you really listen to Nick Saban, I never feel like he's faking me out. He's not. I don't feel like he's trying to put on some character or say what he's just himself.
No, Saban's a little bit more terse than Sarkisian is, obviously.
Right.
But I would be okay with the terse version of that, too, just as long as you're being... Yeah, be boring. Don't give us too much, but just be honest. Don't make it seem like you're trying to mislead us every time you open your mouth.
Yeah, we'll see if the Longhorns are ready for a trip like that. Steve Sarkisian is an interesting contrast to get his thoughts after this game. He has been with a team to Arkansas and, you know, worn the other color, but he's never worn this color. It's different.
Yeah.
It just is. So Bama going in there now versus Texas going in is just, it's a different feel.
Even all these years later.
So we'll see what it looks like Saturday at 6 p.m. Of course, our pregame will crank at 2 o'clock. Come on out and see us. Pluckers, the Link location is where we're going to be for the watch party for Arkansas. So make it part of your plans right now. All right, it's cancel culture time, unfortunately, and where are we at in society? Here we
where
go.
Where are we at in society today?
That's right. Today's Where Are We At Society, brought to you by Hop Water from Whitestone Brewery. It is so delicious. Chad apparently made another fan of the Hop Water over the weekend. Doc Hastings now is on board with the Hop Water.
He likes it.
Found a couple more people myself who now like Hop Water that much more because I introduced it to them. Find out for yourself. You can pick it up at HEB across the Austin area or by going to Whitestone Brewery on 1431 in Cedar Park. It's great by itself. It's great as a mixer, too, as I've found out, with some gin and lime this summer. Whitestone's Hop Water. All right, Chad, cancel culture is something that is often the subject of this segment. Uh-huh. And once again, we find cancel culture in the crosshairs. But this is a meta version of cancel culture. Comedy Central, the self-described leading brand for all things funny, and the network that airs programs such as South Park, used to be Chappelle's Show, and Workaholics, also runs repeats of The Office,
okay,
the television show, the American version of the television show.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you remember early on in that show, they actually had a cancel culture episode where Michael Scott is his typical aloof self and is trying to show what not to do in the workplace while being very insensitive about it. Well, unfortunately, Comedy Central is no longer showing Diversity Day.
What?
Amongst its Office reruns.
Come on, man. You're not showing The Office being its most office?
Yeah, this was first reported by Newsweek, and Comedy Central did admit that they are no longer able to show the second episode of the first season of that show.
That's so good.
Which originally aired March 29, 2005. The episode, which was written by BJ Novak, features Michael Scott being overtly racially insensitive as he attempts to hold a racial diversity seminar. Scott performs a two-bit impression of a Chris Rock stand-up from his 1996 comedy album.
Yep.
Scott, played by Steve Carell, constantly disregards the professional advice from the Dunder Mifflin corporate diversity trainer, played by Larry Wilmore. Scott instructs the Dunder Mifflin employees to wear index cards with different races on them, which only exasperates the situation.
Oh, my God. It's such a good episode. I can't believe they would get rid of that with everything that Comedy Central stands for, with everything they do. Are you going back and cherry-picking episodes of South Park, taking those out?
You may as well just take that show off the air altogether.
No more Christmas episode of South Park? We don't get to hear, what's his name? We don't get to hear Kyle sing It's Hard to Be a Jew at Christmas? What are you doing?
That's a good one. Look, satire is the perfect weapon against ignorance. You point out ignorance in a humorous manner. You make people realize just how stupid it is to think like that. To try and eliminate it altogether, I think, goes against whatever it is you think that you're doing by canceling episodes of shows like this.
It is so bizarre. You know, rather than talk about their mistake, let's talk about one of the other genius moments in that. Okay, that you said that's episode two of the whole show.
Yeah.
Think about how the fourth wall break helps that episode. Think about how they use the fourth wall break.
Where you got Steve Carell being just an unintentional bigot and people looking at the cameras like, I can't believe this is happening right now.
Because you know they're all on the right side.
Yeah.
You know it's him that's being dim and him that's being unknowing of it. But you know deep down also that it's not because he's a horrible human being. He's just a goober. And they're all looking at you like, oh my God, I can't believe
it. I'm so sorry that you're having to witness this.
It was so brilliant. It might be, if you ask me to lay out my favorite episodes of that show ever, I'm going to put that one like top three for sure.
It's memorable for
sure.
I
love that episode.
I haven't seen that show in forever, and I remember that show, that particular episode.
Michael Scott and Stanley in that episode are priceless. Jim is awesome in that episode. Everybody's yelling at him the whole time. What are you doing, Oscar? It's just such a good episode to establish who everybody is.
Well, I hope you enjoyed it while you could, Chad, because it is no more.
Now I got to go find the DVD or digital version. Come on, Comedy Central. All right, there you go. Hopefully they don't cancel the whole dadgum series on Comedy Central there with The Office. All right, coming up, your 2 o'clock hour. We'll dig back into Texas beating Louisiana 38-18. Let us know what you thought, Texas fans. 337-3776. Texas is 1-0 and getting ready for Arkansas, and we're bringing it all to you on the Horn.